about is the hydromechanic comedy. Again, you know, I show you in my last slide, there are 8, 9 properties. So how we can categorize those alpha and hydromechanic property, and that's what I'm going to talk about. So this is the part of the chapter 8 that is specific. So what I'd like to do is, again, divide into a few parts. First is to give you an overview about what's out there, the state of art, how we measure soil moisture, how we measure the structures. So just provide in the laboratory environment, in the field environment. And of course, it's a very quick kind of synthesis. And then I will focus on a method which I call the transient release and inhibition method. And this is the method that we have been a pioneer over a decade at the Calabria School Mine with the U.S. Geological Survey. And this method has been to the degree right now we start to commercialize the global ones. And that, what this method will give us is the so-called characteristic hydraulic connectivity function and suction characteristic in one soil sample, whether it's disturbing or reconstructive, in a 1 week, and wetting and drying. So both can do wetting and drying. All these tests can be done in 1 week. And that's how the technology can push that. Now, let's give some background about the current technology out there. The current technology to measure soil suction or to control soil suction, as you see that, it's quite wide. So the soil suction, how much, what is the range? Typically in the natural environment, it could be a zero, which is at the water table. And then it could be also minus 10, 100, it can up to a million kilopascal. So whether it is a million kilopascal or whether it's a few hundred thousand kilopascal, it's subject to debatable. In other words, the question is how high the soil suction is. So that is the question that's still on there. I think that a lot of people of the clay mineralogy how they interact with water. But the range is like 4 or 5 order magnitude. So you see that because of that, the way to measure and control suction are very challenging. And each of the methods, for example, people know that if you use a congealometer, which is use a ceramic tip, you can embed into soil or crystal material. They can only measure up to 100 kPa. And the reason is that below minus 100 kPa, you will have a phase change called cavitation. So water is going to be more, become vapor phase, 100% probability. So that is difficult to do that. And then the indirect method, you can use a conductivity sensor, thermal conductivity in this case, to measure a material, use a sensor material, that how the thermodynamic change relate corresponding to the suction. And that method has been also moving up to 400. It's an indirect method, but it also has a lot of challenges for that particular method. So it's not widely used. And the next method, what we call the axis translation. So here we start to change the thinking. Instead of manipulating the negative water pressure, which was subject to cavitation, you maintain the water pressure at the atmospheric. Instead, you apply the air pressure. So when you do that, because what we call matrix suction is the differences between air pressure and water pressure. So even though you maintain water pressure as a zero, not a negative, but because you increase the air pressure, then you'll be able to manipulate the matrix suction. So that method has been a wider range to 0 to about 1,500 kPa. But that method has, it has a controversial. Because some people think about that what you do that is different than what the nature, you know, the water is a negative, and the cavitation, all those things. And that's still a subject under debate. But it has been widely used. In fact, that as a translation is the, probably one of the most widely used in the laboratory environment. And then you come to the next method is to use a filter paper. So filter paper is a coffee filter paper. And what's interesting about coffee filter paper is that if you put a coffee filter paper into a closed chamber, for example, like this cup, and then you put a soil on the bottom, you put a coffee filter paper on top, and you close, you wait them to let them reach equilibrium. What we mean equilibrium is the suction has to be the same. But then the water content will be different. But then you can measure water content in the filter paper, take out a measure of filter paper. And you actually, if you do calibration, you can actually know what is the suction of soil. So it's a kind of indirect method. Because if you measure a filter paper, how much water content in the suction in advance, and then you can actually come back to it. But that method looks very, very simple. In fact, it is one of the most widely used because it can have a very high wide range. And in fact, this method has been standardized by ASTM. The downside of that is very tedious, labor intensive. And also, it is a passive method. You cannot put the filter paper into some field condition or a sample you have to test. You can only take a sample into kind of equilibrium chain and that kind of situation. So there is some kind of limit. You cannot control it. You can only passive measure. You cannot control it. But not like an excess translation, you can control it. And there's another method actually still evolving, and this method has some advantages. It's what called thermocouple psychrometer. And what this method do is basically conduct little change of climate environment in a little tiny sensor. Basically, they will measure relativity. So if you put a little sensor like button into the soil, it will measure what is the relative humidity in the air phase or vapor phase in the pores. Because if you know the relative humidity, you can come back to Calvin's equation and then calculate exactly what is the potential of water, soil water, or what is the negative water pressure. Potential is a much more appropriate term. So that's called psychrometer. But psychrometer has also a drawback because they're subject to temperature. If the temperature fluctuates too much, you cannot identify the dew point accurately. But psychrometer has several different versions. So it also starts to improve in some way. But still, field measurement usually is very difficult because the temperature day and night change. Easy 10, 20 degrees of Celsius. And that's a little bit too much for psychrometer. Typically under the laboratory condition. And there's another method which is called isotheric humidity control. In other words, it controls the humidity environment by computer to say, okay, you want a 55% humidity rating. We can mix the vapor and the dry air to 55% humidity, which controls the suction. And then expose the suction, the environment to triaxial, director, and even subsoil samples. That method, in fact, I just want to mention, is we invented in my soil mechanics lab 15 years ago. And it has started to be widely used now. And then there's also two pressure, which basically is a simple version of this humidity chamber, because it basically is a sub. If you have a saturated sodium chloride solution, and you watch it, look at the table, in fact, they have a fixed number of the suction. So you can put a salt, for example, you put a different kind of salt solution on the bottom of this chamber and then put a soil on top, don't touch each other, and close that one. So they will reach equilibrium, and that way it's another way of passively to measure what is the water content in that case, because the soil is going to equilibrium with the solution to the pre-known suction. So therefore you measure the water content, and then you can also, because you know the water content, you know the soil retention, and then you know one point at the soil retention curve. And you're doing a different kind of sound, you get a different kind of solution. And then this is also kind of a tedious and passive. And there's another method, as I show here, chamber actually it is again it's a humidity chamber. It's controlled, computerized humidity chamber. And this method has been last couple of years has been advanced to the lower part that can go to 10 to 15 kPa. But again, that's under laboratory condition. You have to take a soil sample, put it into a little device, just like this printer. Put a little channel so you can do that. 5 minutes, it will tell you how much suction is. Of course, you have to measure water content independent to get a one point. And so basically, these are the method that has been out there to measure soil characteristic curve. And it's been very tedious. Particularly, for example, most useful at the laboratory condition is what we call the excess translation. And that method has been widely used. But the challenge is each time you apply suction, it will take 3-5 days, even longer time, sometimes it will be months, to reach the equilibrium under the particular applied suction of the water pump. So to get one soil water characteristic, typically you have to do a week or 2 weeks, or sometimes 2 months, 3 months. And in addition to that, that method can only do from wet to dry. Now from saturated conditions to unsaturated. It usually will not move from the other way, from the driving way. So it has a lot of limitations. So that's how people measure some of the characteristic curve. And this is last 40, 50 years of advancement. And then the parallel to that, another important property for hydrology as well as mechanics now, is the hydraulic conductivity. You know that it's a function of moisture content or suction. And hydraulic conductivity, again, actually, the status is worse than the soil characteristic curve. It's still, it's kind of an extension of what
original
constant flow, the constant head method. But instead of applying the positive pressure, it applies the suction differences through the sample. So it has a very limited application. But about a decade or 2 decades ago, my colleague and I, we started to explore another method which is called the constant flow. Because of the advance of the medical industry or medical science, they use a very precise constant flow. In other words, the injector flow at a very small rate. It's so small, basically you can do about hundreds of cc, centicubic water, hundreds of cc, so it's of battery a day. So basically, you virtually don't see too much water flow through the sample, but then you can measure the response of the head, and then you can apply Darcy's law to back calculate at the particular set of water content, what is your method. Again, the method is somewhat advanced, but also tedious because it's expensive, involves the plant. And of course, there's some other method which is applied to the sample as a field scale. Yesterday, I talked about this, the green anchor solution. And in fact, that solution also can be applied, not green anchor solution, but same kind of layout that people apply the diffusion equation, and you can do this horizontal, what we call the transient flow method. That can also get hydraulic conductivity function. But those methods, again, is only applied to sandy soil. If you have a CLD clay soil, it will take forever for the wetting front to advance. And also, there's a method called the instantaneous profile. This method can be used in the laboratory as well as the field. In the field environment, in the laboratory environment, here is illustrated, you basically have the sensor to measure at your desired location what is the moisture content. You have also another sensor where you can also measure what is the suction. So if you know the point, and then you can plot that one. In fact, essentially you can get a solar characteristic curve and hydraulic conductivity function when the flow starts. So those methods again, it's very limited. So what I want to talk about in the rest of my 15 minutes or 20 minutes is the method that we have been developed and pioneered and also commercialized. Is the method that we can know all the necessary unsaturated hydrology and mechanical properties, as you see that. Namely, it's a solar retention, hydraulic conductivity function, and the suction stress. And we can do so by wetting and drying, and we can do so one type of soil sample can be completed in 1 week. So here's how this method works. I'd like to show that. Basically, we're using a technology. One is the experiment. We're using transient, number one. We don't use a steady state. We use a transient, so we can have a sample, start with saturated, you apply a couple increment of the suction. When you apply suction, you see that the flow come out, it's a time, it's a flow. This is a two stage of the suction. So when you apply one suction, you see flow go out. When you apply another, you see the flow come out again. So we use that one to do an inverse model. Now we'll fully take advantage of the ability to solve Richard's equation, because this is what the experiment is doing is basically one-dimensional physical experiment. We can use a set up a model to do one-dimensional inverse. So in the case of inverse, basically we use this as a so-called objective function. So we know this, we consider this as a signature behavior, hydrological behavior of the particular soil as objective function, and then you can back calculate the model will use an optimum algorithm back calculate automatically what is your solar characteristic and what is your hydraulic conductivity function. Now of course, once you know the solar characteristic hydraulic conductivity function, we have already established theory that you can actually know the suction stress. But by the same token, you do after let's say 3 days, you reach some kind of stage, and you can decrease the suction. So if you do inversely degree suction, you will see the water start to emit back to the soil sample. So this is the case where the water comes back. And you use this part to inverse the model to get a wetting time of the soil that they're using. Hydraulic conductivity function. So the method basically, in a way, it's quite simple to illustrate it here with the soil step. It has advantages, it can do both wetting and drying. It has no sensor, because we just use the balance to measure how much water outflow and inflow. And it measures both state, complete the curve in 1 week. And also, you can do a disturbance and non-disturbance. Non-disturbance sometimes becomes very desirable because the soil, as we know, that in the field condition, it could be under normally consolidated, only consolidated. And normally consolidated, over consolidated, it will be very different than when you reconstitute the soil in the laboratory condition, even though you get the same kind of porosity. Because the time actually, as time elapses, a lot of structure is going to change. So you can do undisturbed, disturbed, depending on what you want. And the principle, as I said, it's a quite transient method. We fully take advantage of the experiment data that get outflow and inflow. And then we use the commercial code. The code that we're using is specialized. We work with the company called PC Progress in Czechoslovakia. It was pioneered by two of the US well-known soil science, Daniel Nguyen and Jakub Shamiri. And so we work with them to have a special version of the hydrous or hydrous train that actually can be, you know, once you have the experiment data instantaneously or very few minutes, you will immediately know all the parameters you need. So that's basically what we take advantage of. These apparatus actually experience quite a time of evolution, and this was the 1997 version, and that's the 2012 version. Both appearance as well as the principle. Initially, we used some kind of flow pump, as I talked about the constant flow pump. But because of the tedious process of prepare sample, because of the expense of the pump, eventually we give up and we go to the transient version, which you can eliminate pump and just use the balance. So this is a 2005 version, and this is the 2008 version, and then 2012 version. But 2008 version, I will use that to illustrate it because it's quite simple to see that all the components. We have the software control data acquisition, control the section, and we have the cell, which is you can put a sample depending on your size, whether disturbed or not disturbed. And then you can also have the reservoir, which allows you to manipulate and saturate the sample, get the trapped air, because sometimes during the flow process, there will be a dissolution, and then the air come out of the other side of the sample, and you can actually keep tracking of that. And then the balance, the electronic balance, you just hook up to the computer to record your data. So it's quite straightforward. You see that it's only several few components. And then once you do that, you can basically back up the calculated parameters. So I won't go through this some of the detail, but you see that this is the typical data come out of the experiment, the two step of drying, and then two step of wetting. And you get this data in a matter of a week, and then you can use that one to categorize your soil parameters. And what we're trying to categorize, as I said again, is the soil water characteristic curve. So this is a typical illustration of what look like for a soil water characteristic curve. From the 100% saturated to drying, and from drying to wetting. And of course, you can have a somewhere between that, sometimes people call it scanning. So you can do this experiment, use this apparatus. Essentially, what boil down is that you can, in this case, I use a Ning Lu model, and you boil down to the air entry value, which when the soil starts to desaturate, and the pore size distribution that reflects the general shape or the slope of this material. And wetting drying could be very different material, very different parameters. Same material, but different, now in this case, M parameters and alpha parameters could be different. So that's the soil water characteristic we can measure from this. The second one is the hydraulic conductivity function. So this is what the hydraulic conductivity function looks like. You start with saturated, and as you desaturate, the hydraulic conductivity reduces. The red line, they can reduce incredibly to 6, 7, 8 order of magnitude. And then you wet that one, they also can go differently. And you can use our inverse algorithm by objective function. You can get all those hydraulic conductivity parameters. In this case, I use an example using a Mullins model, because the Mullins model was a basis for the Ning Lu model. Both of them are empirical, but it's two of the most widely used models. And the third one is the suction stress model. So suction stress, the concept we established, it has this very simple form. In other words, it's a function of saturation, but also share the same identical two parameters. With the soil water characteristic curve and hydraulic conductivity function. So in a sense that basically you can also measure soil water potential hydraulic conductivity function. Some of the detail about this, how you do the experiment, how you conduct the numerical, essentially you will solve this Richards equation using the inverse model, forward order inverse model, and use the optimization of the Markey-Levenberg type of parameter identification. In fact, this is one of the ideal case to do that. People ask that investment model has a lot of uncertainty. In this case, I would say very little uncertainty because number one, we do one dimension. Number two, our material is just one soil and then one ceramic stone model. So and then so in other words, numerically, it's not a challenge at all. And then you can actually get a very high confidence about the parameter you want to identify. And so these are the typical results. And you can come out the wetting and drying, and then you can see the relation between the inverse model and experiment data to feed for that. And the correspondingly, you can identify those solver the characteristic curve, hydraulic connectivity function. As you see the parameters I showed you here, the 16 different soils, the horizontal reflector of the fit parameter, the vertical reflector, the two parameters. So you can see that 45 degrees means a perfect matching. So for all those alpha m parameters, most of them get excellent results. And this is repeatedly tested. And now we also compare with other methods. So this is the method. The other method I have previously talked about, for example, like excess translation, for those experiment data dot, it will take like 6 months to conduct an experiment. But if we use the method that we are, this train method, you can just get 1 week and get those curves, and then you see the comparison very favorable. And of course, we can also conduct other type of experiment comparison. Again, this is a comparison tool with the other method, as you see that it match excellent. So some other soil, I show you the results that we have, and we can get all those parameters. So I'd like to make a summary so we can have sufficient time for lunch. The couple points. The first one is the hydromechanical property of rehearsal material. So that's this experiment can do for the method that we measure, so the characteristic curve, hydraulic connectivity function. Previous one has been separated, but now we can put together. We can have a good range, and we use a transient method, and actually can try. We already tried up to right now. In fact, at the moment, it's more than 50 soil. We tried 80 soils. I will show you afternoon that the landslide site, the map, the landslide site, we have been doing 6-7 of them in the United States, doing life monitoring, working with the USGS. And each of those sites, we went through this program. In our world, we went through the field sample, and we went through the field monitoring. The sample that we got, we will bring back to the lab, conduct the shear stress test, conduct this train test that will give the necessary hydrological and mechanical property. And we went back to do the modeling to see how stable the hail slope is under the either the historical precipitation environment or the precipitation environment. That way we can have much better feedback. For example, the project that we have right now is have several iterations. The first iteration is drill 8 boreholes and get a sample and then in field instrumentation, monitor for a year. And after that, we come back to the lab, we do all this, and we find, okay, maybe the 8 boreholes, there's only one side, it's likely to have a landslide. Then we can abandon the other one, and we can put a focus on other place. And the rest of the particular one that we can continue to do monitoring. So we start to implement that kind of idea. The idea is to capture landslide. So this afternoon, I will show you some of the case that we have in landslide. So with that, I think what I want to give you the message is I think we feel confident that if you are concerned about in the short term whether a particular slope will have a landslide not under precipitation condition, I think the technology, the advancement from different disciplines is at a stage that we actually can put together quite confident about that answer that questions. And to answer that questions, what as I show you this morning is that we narrow down to hydromechanical property. And there are 3-4 mechanical property, there are 3-4 hydromechanical property that allow us to characterize the material under both saturated and unsaturated conditions. Thank you.